Now, this conversation today is with, well, three of possibly my favorite brains of the year so far, and the knowledge they're going to bring to you today about top performance is something that a lot of people claim, but not a lot of people can deliver. So I don't know if you're like me and have had someone say, oh yeah, we can boost your inquiries by 200%. We can get you this, we can get you that. And you go, so if you can get it, then why can't you get it for yourself? So today we're going to dive straight into the conversation and basically top performance conceptualized has a meaning. So my visual is, I think my top performance comes from the way I manage my brain. What does it mean to, let's go to Lisa, what does it mean to you?
Well, thank you for the question. I really do think that for me, being a top performer, we're joking around in my past of a health and wellness background, but it's like consistently, how you do one thing is how you do and everything. So it's like consistently performing better than your peers over time. And it really consists of quite a few factors. It's like you said, your brain, it's a mindset mastery. It's to get there and stay there. It's changing limiting beliefs. Mm. I help executives identify and overcome negative self-talk and limiting beliefs that hold them back. And this could involve using techniques like reframing and just being more self-compassionate, because us high performers are so hard on ourselves. Instead of taking stock as to like what you've already accomplished, as to like the next thing and the next thing. So it's self-compassion, a growth mindset, enhancing emotional intelligence, strategic goal setting, and making it from there an actionable plan to optimize performance.
Well, there's a couple of things I'll pick up and then I'll hand over to Dr. Irene, because you literally, I saw her face go, yes, that's me. And also you used a phrase from John Wick 4, which is, the hotel manager says to John Wick, he goes, how someone does anything is how they do everything. And you just said that, and it's so true. Dr. Irene, your experience as a top performer, please enlighten.
Oh, I was like the hallelujah chorus. I was like nodding away as Lisa was talking. And it's so true. And I'm sure that there's going to be overlaps with everything that we talk about. Lisa, and you just said how you do one thing is how you do everything. And for me, that's all about what is your identity. Mm. Right? So many people, most of the world does not, you know, don't even think of themselves as top performers, let alone have the ability to become one. And I say become one because that, you know, there's a whole bunch of what I call, you know, BS. And yes, that's part of that's limiting belief systems. It's not just brown stuff. That is all balled up around, you know, who am I to think I can do that? And so where I come at from it is from a neurophysiological standpoint, the unconscious mind and neuroplasticity, like the idea that we're working with basically a caveman operating system. And we really need to upgrade our operating system, our unconscious mind, into like the space age to catch up, because, you know, it keeps glitching out on us. And so that's where my special passion is, the power of the mind, and especially let's remove those unconscious blockages that are keeping you playing stuck and small and safe.
Daniel.
Oh, okay. I'm from Colombia, and I have been flying fighter aircraft for many years. And my top performing leadership comes from that experience, because I have been trained to play in the battlefield and survive and win. And based on that particular training during many years, so I realized that I have that abilities without being aware. So So I easily adapt to the things that are happening normally because that was part of my daily routine. And I can say, as Dr. Irene said, it's part of my identity because while I was flying, I have to be very flexible. I have to be able to adapt to the different things that are happening between the place I took off to the place I have to accomplish my mission. And also to anticipate the things that maybe will happen.
And very quickly.
Yes, very quickly and very close to the ground. And I developed that mindset and I'm using for my personal life, for my professional life, and also to teach leaders how to think in a different way. For example, when the pandemic hits the aviation system, mm-hmm. I was helping the civil aviation in Colombia to write the regulations to be in accordance with the Latin American regulations.
Right.
And at that particular time, people was very scared of what will happen in the future. And I was trying to do something inside the big civil organization department, but they didn't want to do something outside of the box. So I decided to open a kind of webinars. I did maybe 14 webinars to talk with the different pilots from different organizations and leaders from the aviation system to talk about leadership, about how to remove the negative mm-hmm. Thoughts,
yes.
How to remove limiting beliefs, and how to remember that we have the ability to solve problems.
This is very, very interesting to me because you're the second person you're the third person I've interacted with who's been in the forces, and that up to the grindstone, right in it, having to make rapid decisions continuously, burned into your brain. So neuroplasticity. Now, Dr. Irene, I know something that you may wish or may not wish to share. Would you wish to share about your neuroplasticity story?
It's my pleasure. So my pleasure in sharing, not so much the story itself. So 20 years ago, I thought I was a mover and shaker and groover and on top of the world as a doctor, a business person, a single mom, you know, doing it all, and did not realize that I was actually running on empty. I was in adrenal exhaustion as a doctor, didn't know it, and crashed and burned, literally. Literally, while I was driving, lost consciousness in Northern Canada and drove straight into a massive rock face. My 10 bones that I broke were nothing compared to the fact that my two young sons were in the car with me. And what you're referring to about the neuroplasticity is that my four-year-old son suffered a catastrophic brain injury. And took them like weeks before they decided he was going to live, that he was out of the woods. And then they said, he is missing 20% of his brain. I've seen the spec scans. It's true. He's never going to walk again. He's never going to talk again. He's never going to pass high school. And when I said the N-word to the neurosurgeon, neuroplasticity, he literally yelled at me. And tore a strip off me going, no, you don't understand. The tissue's gone. It's gone. I tell you, it's gone. It's impossible. And I went, ooh, okay. So I won't use that word around him again.
Yeah.
And